Hello and welcome to this interview on Money Control. We are in conversation with the founders of PB FinTech, the parent company of Policy Bazaar, Paisa Bazaar, which is set to hit the public markets. They will be raising over 6,000 crore. And joining me on this interview is my colleague Priyanka Iyer. We're in conversation with Yashish Dahiya, the chairman and CEO of PB FinTech, as well as Alok Bansal, the CFO of PB FinTech. They are, of course, also the founders of the company. Congratulations to both of you. It's been a long, grueling 12-year, 13-year journey, but you're finally here on Dalal Street. Yashish, let me start with you. You know, your DRHP kind of laid out the focus areas going forward, and I'm sure, you know, you will look at offline, you will look at health tech, corporate, SMBs, as well as neo-lending. So what is your focus going to be, you know, year one after you're listed? Where's the bulk of your investment going to go to? Because I think 3,800 crore out of this issue is going to be primary. So how are you going to sort of prioritize these areas?
I think the way you said it, it almost felt like we didn't have focus. No, I think our focus will continue to be singular, which is protection for the middle class against financial impact of death, disease, and disability. That has been our focus for the last 13 years and will continue to be our focus, I think, for the next 13 years also. In addition, we will do a lot of other activities which strengthen our primary case. And those may be motor insurance, they may be savings products, they could even be credit cards, personal loans. And I think all of them have their own use cases. But from a passion perspective and from a focus perspective, that continues to be our focus. We have done a small investment in healthcare, in health tech. We have a business called Doc Prime in health tech, which is integrated with the National Digital Health Mission. And you had some press about it, couple of weeks ago. Those are essentially focus. Again, if you actually notice, a lot of the focus would be around insurance. Suppose in the future we go and take an account aggregator license or something of that sort, that again would be focused on the lending area. So I think the primary brands are Policy Bazaar and Paisa Bazaar, and the other activities support them. And I think in terms of use of proceeds, Alok is the best person. But all I wanted to say was, look, this company raised about $350 million, $400 million over the last 13 years. And we still have about 60-70% of that money parked in our bank accounts.
That's right.
So we have built out two brands, both Policy Bazaar and Paisa Bazaar, at about $70 million apiece. Now, I know there were times when Info Edge built out the entire Info Edge with just 7.3 crores. And that is an exception. And we don't, pretend to be in the same category. But it was a different time. I think in these times, building out a consumer internet brand with about $70 million is not a bad result. Yeah. So I think, we will continue to be frugal in the future also. But the focus will stay growth. Alok, you want to comment on the use of funds?
So, Chanda, basically, the way we are looking at our objects of the fundraise, there are four main areas. One is continue to invest behind the awareness, where customers need to, when they wake up in the morning, think about insurance as core part of their financial planning. The second is expansion into the physical stores, where we are seeing that a customer who may buy online or who may talk to call center, who may do a video call with us, also has the option of meeting us in their own city. And this is more about the service, more around increasing the convergence rather than discounting for new business. The third area would be investing behind the international business, where we already have a presence in Dubai for the last couple of years. We took baby steps, we learned a lot about that business and that country. And now we are ready to maybe expand it with a little bit more aggression. And the fourth area would be scouting for investment opportunities or acquisition opportunities, where you know, if there is any specific complementary tech skills, IP team, we'll be happy to look at those options. These are more strategic in nature whenever they happen. Not really looking at market share sort of acquisitions, but these are the four main objects that we have laid out.
Right.
You spoke about your offline plans, and you said this may not necessarily be a customer acquisition funnel, but can you detail that a little more in terms of what sort of investments you'll be putting in there? Because, you know, offline may not be your plan to acquire customers, it's also quite important for a lot of customers who are still doing that transition towards online. So for them, this might be like the perfect vehicle to get onto your platform.
Now, let me explain. Let me start by saying today, how do sales happen, right? Let's say health insurance, life insurance, they happen through a lot of conversations. People speak to somebody, etc. So, a customer comes to Policy Bazaar website, he does the entire research, etc. And once he's done the entire research, he now says, okay, I'm convinced I want to buy product A or product B or product C. And then he has 2-3 options. He can buy through the Policy Bazaar website. Nothing stops the customer. It's absolutely available and a person can do the transaction.
Right.
Or our person in the call center might be able to convince him to make the payment. But the customer can also say that, look, I actually prefer maybe meeting somebody who lives in my locality, because I think at the point of claim, maybe that person will help me more or something. That's what a person can think, right? A person is free to think. Or somebody feels better, sitting across the table and having the conversation with somebody, looking somebody in the eye, than over even a video conference. And so what we did, quite honestly, was in Delhi, where we have most of our people. We started putting in place some ability to go and meet with the customer. And we found very good results out of it. Much higher conversion rates than before. Because you would agree, right, when you're sitting face to face with somebody, your chances of converting are far higher than when you're on a website or even when the customer is equally interested, right? I think the big difference here, and that is what I'm trying to point at, and I'm going to have pains at pointing this, there are a million agents today. What is the biggest pain point that an agent has? The biggest pain point that an agent has is that he doesn't have too many customers. His biggest pain point is not that the fulfillment takes too long or something of that sort. No. His biggest pain point is he has those 5, 6, 10 customers, relatives, friends. Outside of that, he doesn't know what to do. So in a week, and we've done a lot of surveys, what came out was that the person doesn't have work. It is, if I was to take this model, it is a bit like that taxi driver who was in your neighborhood but did not know that you were going to the airport, and you did not know that he was waiting there with the taxi, so you were not able to connect. And what Uber did was just connected these two, and what that meant was a lot more taxi drivers, a lot more people taking taxis, and a fairly efficient service which kind of, you know. And somewhere, insurance is somewhere in between. Well, you don't need to ride a taxi. Out here, you can deal with a fairly digital product, which does not need any touch and feel. But the experience of purchase can be enhanced through the touch and feel. And that is precisely what we are putting in place. But that does not mean, because the moment, and imagine an Uber saying, I'm going to deploy 10,000 taxis, and us assuming that they're going to put these guys in those localities and hope for customers to come and reach out to those people themselves, or for these taxis to roam around finding customers. That is not what Uber did, right? It had an app where customers came and said, I want the taxi, and just connected them. And so what's going to change when Policy Bazaar does this model, and what has changed is instead of meeting 2 or 3 customers a week, this person is probably meeting 7 to 10 ready customers every day who are saying, come and visit me at 9:30, come to my dining room, sit with me, have a tea, and then explain everything to me the way you were doing on the call center so far. When you do so, I will give you a bigger check, I will convert a little more, and I will build a relationship with you, and I'll buy multiple products from you. I think that is what this is about.
And you know, this automatically actually started to play out without a lot of planning during work from home and COVID. Because a lot of our staff, when they went back to their hometowns last year with COVID, you know, somewhere that sort of started their thinking that, yes, they can directly talk to customers, they can visit customers, they can meet the customers, and what impact can it have?
Right. Okay, that is also quite interesting. And also on the lending front, if you can tell us, what are your plans in terms of growth over there? It's also becoming quite a crowded space. So in terms of ensuring that the customer that you deal with is not over-leveraged and growing the vertical in terms of the revenue contribution as well, what are your plans there?
So see, insurance and lending are almost opposite categories. Although they are quite similar in many ways, both require a lot of data, both require a lot of analysis because you're taking risk in both. One doesn't realize, but in insurance, actually taking a bigger risk than lending. Because in insurance, a person is paying you 100 rupees, but the claim can be much, much higher, right?
Right.
At the same time, as a product category, consumers don't want to get up and buy insurance in droves. But if today you stood outside a shopping mall and said, I'm giving loans, a lot of people take loans quite easily. So the demand is much higher. So even Paisa Bazaar has almost doubled the traffic of Policy Bazaar. Because obviously insurance customers are hard to get. And so yes, on one side, it's an easy product to give to customers. But then your big challenge is no one supplier can cover the entire market. And there is a vast array of segments of consumers. There is prime, subprime, salaried prime, you know, non-salaried prime, non-salaried non-prime, below prime, near prime. And to cover that entire market, a marketplace is best suited because it creates a panel of suppliers who can cover every need. Every need has a different cost. And eventually, you know, things like peer-to-peer, etc., just tend to become part of that to some extent. Because wherever institutions may or may not be willing, or peers can come and compete with the institutions also.
Got it.
So I think it's going to be an interesting dynamic. There is also a new lending element, a new, you know, element to it, which I think as time progresses, you will see us do a lot more of. You know, white label partnerships. You've seen some of them come through. But clearly the direction is the same. And yes, today it's a crowded market. Everything is crowded today. And maybe in India for the next 10, 15 years, it's going to stay that way. I don't know. I'm no, you know, crystal gazer. But
right.
But I think, you know, Paisa Bazaar is holding its ground.
Right. Yashish, you spoke about the market opportunity for insurance. In terms of the risks here, one, of course, is the risk that, you know, a lot of these insurance partners now want to own the stack end to end in terms of distribution. They want to own the customers, own the data. We've seen examples of HDFC Ergo delisting. The other is there are a lot of these niche insurance providers who are coming up with bite-sized insurance policies, you know, the likes of your Toffee, Plum, Digit, and so on. So where do you see Policy Bazaar positioning itself, you know, amidst all these changes that are happening in the insurance business?
So see, Policy Bazaar is essentially focused on, first of all, customer education. That the customer must be educated about the need for health insurance and life insurance. To me, that is the biggest requirement right now for the entire industry. Because 80% of the people who go to big hospitals do not have health insurance. I'm sure 80, 90% of people do not have life insurance. What happens if tomorrow morning a salaried person earning well, taking care of his family is no more? You know, the family may or may not have thought about it. What if both husband and wife expire in an accident? What happens in those situations? And maybe the only thing they have is a personal accident cover of 5 lakh rupees. Is that going to take care of the costs? How are things going to be addressed, right? I think there's serious matters. And we are, you know, massively focused on that education part. Now, what does that education do? So when the customer gets up in the morning, he's coming to us in large numbers. And when he comes to us, there is a certain advantage that an insurance company has in promoting their product to such a large customer base. And that is why, you know, a lot of companies are partners with us. And we cannot sell or acquire customers unless we have great products from companies. So to me, it is a symbiotic relationship, which sometimes takes time. Some companies have a desire to essentially say that, okay, I will be the you know, only platform. I think if there are more than one companies that want to do that, then again the aggregator model or the web broker model starts to become quite important, because the customer requires that. He requires to compare, and who is going to provide that independent comparison? Everybody will obviously say good things about their product, right? So I think it's an interesting piece you bring in. We are somewhere, see, the policy we sell is not ours. The claim we pay is not with our money. So somewhere we can be trusted to provide that independent advice, because to me, whether you as a consumer, whether you buy from company A or company B, it's the same thing to me.
Got it.
Pillar. Yeah. And the second part is, when you have your claim, I'm not paying. So to me, from a customer service perspective, it's important that you get paid. And hence, I will work with you in, if there's any miss from the insurance company, in convincing the insurance company to pay a genuine claim, right? At the same time, I don't want a bad book. So if it's a fraudulent claim, I will work with the insurer in identifying that form. But you appreciate there isn't a conflict here, because suppose you have a claim of 7 lakh rupees, that 7 lakh rupees does not go from my pocket, but it does go from the insurance company's pocket. So at an inherent level, they may, like, I have no conflict in this situation. And as a consumer, you may prefer to deal with somebody who doesn't have that conflict. You may prefer to deal with somebody. And the last part I would say is, as a consumer, what do you lose? You are paying the same price. You're getting the same claim. You can either deal with the company only, or you can deal with the company and us. We don't charge you anything extra. We don't charge you anything extra, right?
Right, yeah. Point taken, Ashish. Also, if you can help us understand your plans in terms of how do you, when do you see you yourself becoming profitable? Your losses have, of course, reduced drastically. It was also an important year for insurance because of COVID. So how will the path to profitability be like going forward from here?
So, genuinely, profitability is a choice which we can achieve any quarter we wish to. It is not a priority. It is not a priority because right now we are in an underpenetrated, I just mentioned 80% of people don't have health insurance. In that situation, do you try to become profitable for the 20% that are buying health insurance, or try to convince the remaining 80% to also buy health insurance? I think the answer is quite clear. You try to convince the 80% to also buy health insurance. So I think we are in a phase where we are growing market for the next 5, 7, 10 years, long, long journey ahead. And yes, on a unit economics basis, the business is profitable. So every time we do business, we are prudent. We do not lose money. Another proof of it is, you know, we've raised about $400-500 million, but we spent much less of it. So about 60%, 70% of the money that we've raised in our lifetime is still in our bank. That tells you that just because we have access to a large sum of money does not mean we start spending. Prudence, you know, Sanjeev from InfoEdge says it very well. The best companies in the world, built over decades, are the ones that have focused on return on capital employed. That is what we believe is the true value. We have burnt $150 million, which is a lot of money, but the company's value is $6 billion. And from a return on capital, that's a decent return on capital. all our investors have done well. That is proof of the fact that we have not burnt through billions of dollars to achieve billions of dollars.
Unlike many other companies that are going public.
No, it was. I'm sorry it came out that way. It was not meant to be a comment on anybody. Everybody has their own reasons. It's very hard to build these businesses.
Got it.
You know, I'll tell you honestly, I think many a times it's very easy to comment. It's very hard to build.
Understood.
But I was certainly not aiming to comment on anyone.
Got it, Yashish. But, you know, as we wrap up, I know you're running out of time. Just one final question, Yashish. You're also an unusual entrepreneur in the sense you come from a very different background. I remember you saying once that you're perhaps the only civilian in a family that's, you know, had a lot of members in the armed forces. You've completed the Ironman triathlon. So, you know, all these experiences, these life experiences, how did it shape you as an entrepreneur in the way you've built PB FinTech in the last decade?
So there is a kind of mission aspect to me. It's not just a financial aspect. So I think I could have had a very simple alternate life as an army person. There is a mission aspect to me, which is quite clear. It's not just a financial aspect. And yes, of course, we have to all, in the civilian world, money has to be also made. Also in the army world, my parents also have made money in the sense they get pensions and all that stuff. It's good. But all I'm saying is there is a mission purpose. And I think that mission purpose is quite deep. I usually find that I'm able to focus on the core purpose, which is in this case, the health and life insurance for the middle class in India, and keep that primary and not get digressed from it by other pieces. I think also my experiences kind of have given me a very unique piece because, you know, when we were in the army till I became an adult, all my costs were covered by the military, you know, by the military hospitals. It was when I became an adult that I realized, oh, as a civilian, you've got to pay for all these things. I genuinely did not know you had to pay for these things because it was supposed to be. And then also my stint in the UK, you know, healthcare was always there. So to me, the fact that we don't think about these issues is very alien, that people don't think enough about the fact that there will be a health. I've always had this, right, since I was a civilian, that deduct 12%, 15%, 20% of my salary, but give me the same benefits as a government job, which is, you know, give me a pension, give me a healthcare, take 30% of my salary. But I don't think people appreciate it as much as I do because, you know, I come from a world where that was the norm. That was the only norm. We did not understand this other norm.
On that note, here's wishing you the best for the IPO. And thank you again, Alok and Yashish, for joining us on Money Control.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.